volunteers from all over that can help educate and entertain us. He happens to do both, so. Gary Karp is an author and speaker whose goal is to enlighten society to the radical changes that have taken place in what he calls modern disability. A wheelchair user following a spinal cord injury he incurred in 1973 at the age of 18, Gary has produced 4 books, written extensively as a disability journalist, and speaks to a wide array of audiences across the U.S., including universities, rehab centers, business, government, and conferences, where he's remembered for his passion, clarity, and humor, as well as his dazzling juggling skills. In 2007, Gary was inducted into the Spinal Cord Injury Hall of Fame as a disability educator.
We are in the process of one of the most amazing social transformations ever in the entire history of humanity on the planet. That might sound a little grandiose to some of you, but I really believe that it's true, and hopefully you'll feel the same way after I've made the case here. Just an amazing amount of change has been happening. What it means to have a disability now is radically different than it has ever been before, because of some very clear, observable changes that have been taking place. For one thing, more people with disabilities are surviving, such as premature babies living longer, many sometimes impairment. Generally, though, because people with disabilities are more active and are more committed to living a life, they're healthier. There's this perceptual, conceptual contradiction, you know, of disability and health. Well, they're not mutually exclusive. I happen to be very healthy in the context of my disability. And people with disabilities are much more mobile than ever before in a far more accessible world. And people with disabilities are more educated because that accessibility has extended to education from the beginning all the way up to higher education. And empowered by technologies that made all kinds of things possible for them, not the least work, because work is far less about physical labor, much more about information. And a lot of this has happened thanks to advocacy success, that's a hard thing to say, on the part of people with disabilities themselves. They have fought for their innate right to live to the potential that they know exists. Amazing amount of change, which means that we have an emergent population of people. We have an emerging, immense amount of human capacity and potential. And that means that we need to start thinking differently about disability, because we're still operating on a lot of old models. But I'm here to help you catch up. I'm here to close the gap. Let's take a look at the current snapshot of what disability is really about today in this modern age. Of course, I have learned something about this story personally through my own experience. Here I am in 1973, when I was 18 years old. All the rest of you can laugh at it too. And I know some of you have even more embarrassing photographs from the 70s, am I right?
Yeah.
But we were cool in the 70s. This was hip back then. This is me at my girlfriend Rowena's prom, and this is also the last photograph of me standing. I grew up in the suburbs of Detroit, a place called Southfield, Michigan, and there was a huge storm that came through in the summer of 1973, and it especially damaged a lot of trees. So a neighbor hired a few friends and I to clear his property. So it took us 2 days to break up all the branches and carry them away. And there was a tree in the front yard that was damaged. He wanted it cut down. He was offering us $300. I would have married his daughter for $300. Of course, I was an 18-year-old boy. So I was in a kind of mind of, I can do anything. And I wanted to impress my friends. I was over 6 feet tall, so somebody had to climb up in the tree to cut off a large branch first. And I was sort of the candidate. I'd never used a chainsaw in my life, but there I was, 25 feet up in a tree. The neighbor, of course, was being cheap and irresponsible. He didn't even supervise. He never should have allowed us to be doing this in the first place. So it's this convergence of a very irresponsible adult and an 18-year-old kid who thought he could do anything. And I felt secure up there. I was standing in this sort of crook with these thick branches. I was leaning forward at an angle, but no belt or strap or anything. And as soon as I started cutting into that branch, it was very large and long, and it started breaking off from its own weight, and the tree shifted, and it literally threw me out. So I fell 25 feet, and I broke two of my vertebrae in my lower back and compressed my spinal cord, and I was unable to move or feel the lower half of my body as soon as I was on the ground. So for me, it was an immediate change of my life disability. But then what happened was, of course, I went through a very intensive medical process. I had surgery. In 1973, when you broke your spine, you had to lay straight for weeks while the surgery healed. And they had me in an interesting device called a circle bed. You can kind of see it coming up the left side of the picture there. Because I couldn't sit or turn or anything like that, they used this essentially Ferris wheel with a bed across the middle to flip me around to change my position from my back to my stomach so that I wouldn't experience skin breakdown. The nature of it in the 70s. Nowadays, they surgically stabilize the spine, people grow sooner. This is what I went through. So I had 6 weeks to lay around and sort of digest what had happened and let everybody come and show me how much they loved me and bring me gifts and glue and some food and Playboy magazines and this amazing outpouring of support. And I was a third child. I am a third child. My brothers are 5 and 8 years older than I am, so I was an attention-starved kid. So in a way, this was perfect for me. And the thing to understand about this is that your gut intuitive reaction to a story like this, that it must have been a time of great depression or anger. I'm often asked this question, how did you deal with the incredible darkness that you must have gone through at the time? But what I'm asking you to understand, to really know, is that there's a very wide range of the way people cope with traumatic change like this. I wasn't wired to do anger and pushing people away. I was wired for approval seeking. So for me, it was more a matter of being positive and upbeat, sort of type A, what am I going to do? That's the way I coped. In fact, denial is the way that I was coping with that. One of the deepest lessons about disability, and what I think people with disabilities model for all of us, and these kinds of stories of traumatic change model for all of us, is that we're all wired to respond to these kinds of things in some way. We all have these coping mechanisms. And your initial reaction, I'm sure, hearing a story about an 18-year-old boy paralyzed, is heartbreaking, isn't it? We're compassionate beings, so of course you have this very strong feeling about what happened to me. And it's because we're human, because we have big hearts, because we respond in very loving ways about this kind of stuff. So I appreciate your feeling that way about it. And now, please get over it. It was 39 years ago. And this is one of the important things to understand, that we tend to be stuck. I call it being stuck in sympathy. We tend to define people by that event. I had a tragic experience when I was 18, of course, but I haven't had a tragic life because of it. Not a tragic person because of it. I had to move through a process of adjustment and adaptation and coping and grieving. That's what human beings do, but we don't stay stuck in it. It's very, very common, in fact, not the rare, heroic, inspirational thing. That people move through when they get what they need, and what I got that I needed was rehabilitation. After that 6 weeks, back and forth in the circle bed, the party was over, and it was time to get down to some really serious work. I was transferred to the Detroit Rehabilitation Institute, where they drove me like a pack horse. 7 weeks of hard labor. In other words, I got trained. I am very well prepared to return to the community and be able to function. A big part of how people with disabilities do what they do is technique. A lot of it's just method. It looks really mysterious and remarkable and amazing, but it's just like kind of magic. In other words, you just don't know what the trick is. So it looks amazing to you. But it really is just about how we do it. And so I spent 7 weeks in rehabilitation being taught the skill set. How to dress myself, how to took care of my body, of understanding certain clinical needs. They taught me wheelchair skills, wheelies, and they made me very, very strong. The weightlifting was really intense. They took this skinny 18-year-old kid and turned him into this hunk of man. All right, that hurt my feelings. 7 weeks later, here I am, still with hair, still hot. And out there in the world, and actually very, very well prepared to function in terms of technique. Obviously, there were a lot of other adjustments to make. But boy, 39 years ago, things were really different than they are now. So that whole list of stuff, I have been direct witness to how different things are. There were no curb cuts, there were no blue parking spots, there were no wide elevator stalls. Many buildings I had to go in back doors or be carried up and down stairs very often. So I have been able to be a direct witness to this really phenomenal transformation. And one of the first things that I noticed when I was first out in the community is that people didn't understand who I was in the context of my disability. They didn't understand how I did what I did. They didn't understand what it meant to me as a person. And they didn't really get that I'm still pretty much the person that I always was. It doesn't really change you in the most essential ways. But everybody was reacting to me so differently. So even though there's been all of this change and this emergence, nonetheless, people really don't get what it's about. And we're more visible, right? You all know people with disabilities of all kinds are out in public and active, and we've all seen this. But I don't think that in general, society as a whole really understands what it means. And the most essential thing that it means is that we're really just people, that we're really unchanged. I brought a few friends along with me to pitch into the conversation. This is Judy Smith. Judy is quadriplegic from a broken neck that she experienced 30-some years ago in a car accident. She grew up in Texas. Judy is the executive director of the Axis Dance Company, which is an international traveling professional dance company that includes people with disabilities. And here's how she makes the point.
It's important to realize that people are people. We all breathe air. We all bleed red blood. And, you know, regardless of what kind of a package we come in, we're really not so different from one another. And, you know, I think we all just need to relax and realize that we all want kind of the same thing out of life.
First rule here is that people with disabilities are people. I mean, they're really remarkably like people. They think, they feel, they have organs, they, you know, they enjoy their lives. It's kind of an amazing thing. And it's funny, but the truth underneath that is how powerful the presence of a disability is and how strongly people react to that. And it's out of proportion with who the person really is. So what you want to do is you really want to focus on the person first. You don't want to focus on the disability first. And the way I know that people see my disability first is they all often tell me stories about, oh, my Aunt Gladys had polio, you know, in the 50s. Or I got a neighbor down the street, you know, and oh, he just does everything, he's so amazing. And somehow they think that they have to relate to me around my disability. I'm happy to have a conversation about disability, but if it's the first thing out of your mouth, it tells me that that's how you're primarily seeing. So the etiquette is, no, just connect with the person first around whatever the reasons are that you happen to be in the same, you know, airspace together. And then that way you'll connect more authentically. And there are a lot of us. There are 54 million. This is the typical number that's usually thrown around. You know, 54 million people in the United States with disabilities. And it's a very, very wide array of kinds of disabilities. People with mobility disabilities, such as me. People with physical disabilities, which could be a facial disfigurement or amputation, that's necessarily a mobility disability. Sensory disability, of course, would be blindness, deafness, and it's a $5 fine for the.
didn't answer.
Cognitive disabilities, which of course includes developmental disability, such as Down syndrome, traumatic brain injury, learning disabilities. Anybody math challenged, by the way? Okay. You have an officially recognized disability. But do you think of it as a disability? Maybe you do, but many people who are math challenged, they don't really identify it as, yes, I have a disability. It's just the reason that you're not a physicist. You get the principle here? People follow their abilities, not their inabilities. And that's what people with disabilities do. Same thing. They look for their potential, they don't dwell on what they've lost, they don't put themselves in situations where they know they're not going to be able to do things like anybody else. It really is so much the same. But I want to talk about, since this is National Disability Employment Awareness Month, I'm going to talk about this body of people who are employed. There certainly is a component of the population of people with disabilities where those disabilities are very, very significant, and they're not people who are going to be independent or employable necessarily. But what I'm here to tell you is that there is a growing and large segment of people that happen to have disabilities who are absolutely employable. But look at the situation. First of all, and these numbers come from a variety of sources, such as the U.S. Census. So the 24 million actually is from the U.S. Census, people who checked off they have a disability. And the National Organization for Disability in Washington, D.C., and the Lewis Harris polling folks have been doing some surveys over the years. So these numbers are pretty reliable. So first of all, 72%, 72%, 24 million people are unemployed or have a disability. Really a large number, 17.25 million people not working. All right, but of those 72%, there is a chunk that doesn't want to work. Can we jump in here a little bit? Okay, we're missing a slide. So I don't know the exact number, but you can see it's about, where are we? It's about another 25% or so don't want to work. And well, that's because they maybe they're in school, maybe they're raising a family, maybe they've already sold their internet company for $1 million. Or maybe they don't believe they can because they've bought into social messages about disability and therefore they subscribe to this notion that they're not employable simply because they have a disability. And then there are people who really believe that their disability precludes them from being able to work, and they're the ones who don't necessarily know how it could work. They don't really understand how they could make adaptations and accommodations and so on to work. But even when you do that, you take all those people out of the formula, we're still left with 3.5 million people with disabilities who say that they can and want to work. And I believe this is a conservative number. I think it's actually much larger. So we're talking about a pretty significant slice of the human family who are being held back from their potential, and that we are being denied what they have to contribute in our society. This is a very, very significant issue. So what's holding everybody back? Well, there's a whole array of belief systems that we still operate on, a number of stereotypes, and you know, it's really nobody's fault. This stuff comes from media and the arts and from history and from our own projections and notions of what we think it would be like. These are entirely natural things. So I absolve every one of you in this room right in this moment that no one is to blame for whatever you think or feel about disability, because so much of it comes externally, and just it's in there. It was in my brain too. In fact, it was one of the most significant parts of my adjustment process was getting clearer of the stuff that was in my head about disability as I was discovering what it really was. So let's review some of these stereotypes. And for starters, people think that we all need help. By definition, if you have a disability, you need help. And there's sort of a scouting mentality, you know, in our culture. Good deed for the day. Oh, the guy in the wheelchair. Let's run after him and open the door. Literally, people chase after me. Open the door. It's very stressful. This is another point of etiquette that I want to share with you. You know, do not chase people down to open the door for them, especially if it looks like they, you know, got it together. I'm rehabilitation, you know, on command, and I'm really good at opening doors. If you happen to get there just before I do, then by all means, you might have opened it for me anyway. Of course, my favorite thing to do is to get there just ahead of other people and hold the door for them. And it's amazing how that stops people in their tracks, like, whoa, reality shift. I'm not supposed to be helping you. Really, it's okay. Go ahead, go through the door. When you have a disability, when you have lost the ability to do whatever, things that you can still do for yourself, right? are that much more precious to you. So again, the intuitive, compassionate thing is, oh, let's see if I can do something to make this person's life maybe a little easier, because you think that it's difficult for us to live with our disabilities. So in imposing help on somebody, you're actually robbing them of something very, very precious to them. And it's just part of the texture of our lives that people are constantly offering us, you know, help that we don't need. And it's really nice when more people understand this and spare us from that constant kind of interaction that we have with so many people that's around the question of whether or not we need help, rather than just connecting as people, which is what we really want to do. So this is Eli Gillard, and Eli was born with a form of dwarfism, and he's the executive director of an independent living center in Northern California, where I live.
And my feeling is I'm happy to accept help, but I love to initiate. So if I'm reaching for something on a shelf, I definitely don't want someone coming behind me and trying to say, oh no, let me get that for you. Now I will ask you if I need you to get that for me. But if I'm scaling the shelf, that's my prerogative. And if someone comes behind me and is trying to, you know, whisk it like Superman to grab that, you know, can of soup, he might throw off my balance, and we'll both be in trouble.
Help isn't always help, ladies and gentlemen. So, you know, when people open that door for me, half the time, they stand in my way when they do it. Which brings us to another important point for you to understand. People with disabilities are skilled at how they live with their disabilities. We are experts at how we live with our disabilities. We know what we're doing. We know whether we need help. And if we need help, we know how it should be done. So if you think somebody needs help, by all means, make the offer. That's fine. But then take no for an answer unless they're about to kill themselves, which is very rare. And if the answer is yes, allow them to guide you. Because not only do they know the right way to do it, but also it keeps the relationship more equal, more balanced, rather than this sort of, oh, I'm helping you, and you're helping me, and I'm going to sort of be passive about it. Now, in the workplace, one of the most pervasive stereotypes is that people with disabilities simply aren't productive. And we know this from a survey that was done by the Department of Labor, the Office of Disability Employment Policy, ODEP, O-D-E-P. If you're writing, please make note of that. It's a very, very rich information source about disability and employment. And they did a study of employers, and they asked them a number of questions, such as, you know, what are your concerns about hiring people with disabilities? And look at this. Since I'm talking about productivity, people with disabilities may not be as safe and productive as other workers. 45.7% overall of companies of all different sizes. Look how pervasive this core doubt is about whether people with disabilities are even productive employees, even capable of it, by virtue of simply having a disability. This is Dimitri Belser. Dimitri lost his sight in his early 20s. He has limited vision. He works at a computer, large screen, you know, right up to his face. But he's the executive director of the Center for Accessible Technology in Berkeley. Here's what he's got to say on this point.
I think the people that use this as a motion are going to say, well, this is why I don't want to hire people with disabilities, because we have to keep people working at a certain level. And they have no basis for that knowledge, for that statement. They are just saying it because they have a stereotype about how people with disabilities work. The reality is, yeah, you'll find some people with disabilities who are not good employees, and you'll find some people with disabilities who are great employees. But you'll find men who are good employees and men who are lousy employees. It's any category of people you're going to find a whole range of their productivity, and people with disabilities are just the same, just like everyone else.
Productivity is not a function of disability. It's a function of the individual person. It's a function of how prepared they are, the kind of goals they set for themselves, whether they're going to be a good fit with the culture of the workplace, and on and on and on. In other words, you do the same thing that you do when you're hiring anybody else for a job. You look for those things. And if there's a disability issue, then there might be questions about, well, how will you perform this essential task of the job? You don't have to ask about disability. It's so easy not to step over the line of the law on that point, by the way. Employers are often afraid of even interviewing somebody because, oh, I might say the wrong thing and then they're going to sue me. Well, you don't have to say, hey, what's your disability? All you have to say is, how will you perform this essential task of the job? It is so simple, so safe, so easy. And many people with disabilities will show up and just tell you. And of course, existing employees who acquire disability, it's the same conversation. How can we adapt? It's about thinking of disability as something to which people adjust and adapt, rather than something that people can't do. She does this every time. She steals the show for a moment. Okay, thank you, Joe. But this is not just about the employer's attitude. It's also about social attitude and how that gets inside somebody's head. Sit. Don Price is quadriplegic from a spinal cord injury. He broke his neck at about the C5 level. That's fairly low. So he has limited use of his hands, but he uses a power wheelchair. He's also a disability advocate, and this was his experience.
I've been kind of told or led to believe that there wasn't a lot available for somebody with a severe disability, and that employers weren't necessarily looking for people like me or willing to make the accommodations. Well, you know, once I started working and realizing that I don't need a whole lot of accommodations, and I can do the job if I have the tools, then I became more confident and was able to see myself as a valuable employee.
People with disabilities get this message. Kids with disabilities get this message. You'll graduate, you'll go on Social Security. Or you'll be able to work just in this kind of setting because, no, you shouldn't shoot higher for this kind of career, whatever it is, because they're not going to want to hire you. That stuff gets put in people's heads. And then you have to be somebody, you know, strong enough, like Don here, to say, well, I'm not so sure I'm going to believe that. I'm going to find out for myself. People shouldn't have to do that. We need to change the social foundation of the way we think about disability so that every kid, every person who acquires a disability at any stage is thinking in terms of, I'm going to find out what the potential is, rather than, I'm not going to be able to do this, or nobody's going to let me do this. Really a radical change in thinking that is part of how we're going to embrace this emergent population. Another stereotype is that we're all angry cripples. And people said this to me, oh, I'd be angry if it was me. Right? Well, that's because, you know, the notion of from your walking or non-disabled perspective is that, yeah, if I suddenly couldn't, I'd be angry. Well, you might be, but 39 years later, no, your focus would be on who am I as a person, what's my life about, I want to get out there and get on with it. And many people who do cope in that early stage of an acquired disability by being angry, which is a reasonable response, many of them reach a moment where they wake up in the morning and they realize, you know what, this actually is not kind of the life that I want to be living. I'm pushing all the people that I love away and I'm not enjoying myself too much, so maybe I should let go of the anger thing and get it at its place. This is Jan Garrett. Jan was born without limbs. She has one foot, I think, down in one of her lower limbs. And she's an attorney. She's worked in the Justice Department. She's a law clerk. She's very successful. She's married. And here's how she talks about the angry group.
I'm not angry about having a disability because it's part of who I am. And I'm not angry about who I am, or you know what I've had to do in coming to be who I am in my life. But sometimes things do make me angry. When the elevator opens for the subway and someone has urinated all over the floor of the elevator, and that's my only way of getting down into the subway because I pay the same as everyone else does to use the transportation, and I believe that the accessibility should be maintained so that I don't feel like I'm, you know, rolling through someone's bathroom.
You get the difference here? She's not angry about having a disability. She gets angry as an appropriate emotional reaction to something that interferes with her being able to live her life like everybody else. And again, this is not a rare thing. But the stereotype of the extremes, it's either this tragic, horrible, life-destroying fact, or you have to be a heroic, inspirational figure who overcomes their disability. Think about that word. If you have to overcome your disability, does that mean that anybody could do it? Or does it mean you have to be that real, exceptional, rare individual who's capable of doing this? I don't consider myself as having overcome my disability. I adapted to my disability. I got what I needed. I got the training that I needed. And I have a world that they're increasingly getting stuff out of my way so I can function. 39 years later, much, much, much easier to live than it ever was before. So it tends to be seen in the extremes, but what it really is just people. It's really just people in the middle. Just, okay, give me what I need so I can get on with my life, get stuff out of my way, see me accurately for the whole person that I am, and that my disability is just a component of that, and let me get on with it, you know, and do what everybody else wants to do. Spend time with my friends and my family, do stuff that I enjoy, you know, run the errands, keep a nice household, pay my taxes, all the rest. That's the way people think about it, and that really is the reality. But again, we tend to think of it in terms of the extremes. So here's Dimitri again. He's got something powerful.
One thing that happens a lot with people with disabilities that drives me kind of crazy is that people talk about people with disabilities as if they have some sort of bravery, some sort of nobility. The fact that I'm blind and I live out in the world and I live my life, that makes me a brave person. I'm not brave. I'm living my life. My blindness is part of who I am, part of what I have to deal with in my life, and I deal with it. And that's just what is. It's not bravery, it's not nobility, it's just life.
When you're seeing people in these terms of elevating them up on these pedestals, you can't really interact authentically with us that way. You're really missing so much of who we are. Now, again, to have the reaction of like, wow, that really seems remarkable to me, you know, and that if you have an interest in understanding how they live and how they feel about it, sure, that's if you want to know who I am as a person and you want to connect with me, that's one thing. But if it's, oh, you're so amazing, you're so remarkable, wow, 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 then it's hard to find your way into actually connecting. And if the employer is thinking in these terms, now we have a problem. Because the bar is being artificially set high. If the employer is interviewing somebody or considering an existing employee being able to stay on the job, and they're thinking, is this one of those rare, heroic, remarkable people who can overcome their disability? You get how the standard suddenly has been raised, and that tends to disserve a person with a disability and the organization that can either hire or keep that kind of person because they're being expected to meet the standard that everybody else doesn't really have to meet, instead of just see us as people. Disability tends to be thought of in medical terms. People think that I another thing I get asked, how often do you go for therapy? I don't. I'm done being a patient. I'm not a patient. I'm a person who is with a disability. So seeing me in medical terms is a mistake. You walk. That's just my normal. It is. It's integrated into me. But in terms of society, in terms of policy, in terms of politics, we think of disability too much in medical terms rather than in independence terms, because that's what it's about. We need to be investing in independence. We need to make sure that people get their medical needs met at the beginning. But what's happening is we are saving more lives. We're getting people through rehabilitation and so on. And then they return to the community, and then suddenly they stop getting what they need in order to achieve what's actually possible for them. So we've got some quirks in the way we think about this in terms of policy. I don't have time to get carried away on a whole rant, but I could, because times like this during elections, when there's all this hue and cry about Medicare and Social Security and Medicaid and entitlements and all this kind of stuff, and then they're cutting and cutting and cutting, instead of let's look at the people who don't even need or want to be on those programs, right? And get them off Social Security. It doesn't mean kicking people off the program. It means giving them what they need so they can get out and work because they want to, and many of them aren't because they're afraid of losing personal assistance services. Okay, I said I was going to get to here. But it's a really important thing. But it is a mistake to see us in medical terms. So Jan has something to say about that.
Well, it's interesting in terms of how people see me, whether they see me in a medical model sort of way, as a patient or as somebody who needs to be cured, perhaps, or whether they see me, you know, as just a regular person going about my business, going about the day, is sort of interesting. I've rarely been in a hospital, honestly. I'm a very healthy person. I don't have a lot of medical problems. I did have Harrington rod surgery to straighten my spine, and so I was in the hospital for a time and in a cast for a while for that. But that was when I was 15 years old, and haven't been in a hospital since.
So, if somebody that you can imagine how many people would look at her and think, oh, she's under constant medical care. It's just not true. And I'm really curious about the notion of people who say to her that they want to heal her, what, she's going to grow arms and legs? You know? And that's an important thing to understand about this. So reality is a very strong thing. If you can't walk, then you can't walk. And you just don't dwell on it after a while. When you lose the ability to walk again, there's an adjustment process. But me now, I don't spend my time wishing that I could walk any more than you spend your time wishing you could fly under your own power. It's simply not an option, so you don't think about it. There's nothing heroic or amazing about that. It's just your natural perspective, and so it's the way you think. And it's the same thing with not being able to walk, not being able to see, not having your limbs. People have that natural perspective of this is what is, so I'm just going to move on with however it works. And I'm going to be creative about how it works, and I'm not going to let people tell me I can't do that. That's what human beings do. We are wired to reach for our potential. Every single one of us. And again, I think that that's what this disability story models. It's not just about the disabled. It really is about all of us and what we get to discover about ourselves when you look at this story. But people with disabilities are not sick. Spinal cord injury, paralysis, I'm not sick. Somebody who's blind is not sick. Somebody who's short stature is not sick. Somebody with facial disfigurement, not sick. Somebody with diabetes who is managing their blood sugar levels over the course of a day is not sick. You know what's really sick? People who still drive cars. Now that